The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Father, we just thank you for the season that we're in. I have to laugh when I think the season we're in. God has clearly given us a season. And the season we're in is one where the plowman is overtaking the sower or the reaper, whatever. It's like it's so confusing at that point that things are happening so fast and so suddenly. It was funny, we preached the message some time ago that the goodness of God was going to suddenly startle you. I've been nothing but startled. I'm actually kind of worrying about my heart at this point. I'm being startled by his goodness so regularly that it's like I don't know when it's going to stop. It's like I'm being stalked. Goodness and mercy are following after me all the days of my life. And so that's a good kind of stalking, by the way. When goodness and mercy overtakes you and catches up and swallows up. All right, just a little bit of lightness before I get into a heavy message that's going to devastate you. So I just thought, now remember, should preface every sermon with, if a sermon ever sounds too hard, I'm making excuses before I give it. If a sermon ever sounds too difficult, it's the failure on our part to realize that everything's done by grace and it's the divine enablement to be and to do all that he called us to be, all that he called us to do is coming from the personal presence of Jesus. So you okay with that? All right, then I'm ready. Father, we just pray this day that the steps of ascension is to move forward and upward in the things of God and that we are preparing our heart now to know how to move forward and upward in the things of God. And so, Father, we just ask that your blessing would be upon this word and that you would anoint our ears to hear in a very practical way how we can enter into growing in the grace and in the knowledge of God. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. The title of the message is Forward and Upward and Steps of Ascension. Forward and Upward. When I was a young Christian trying to, in a very tangible way, get areas in my life sanctified. I wanted to understand that big word, sanctification. And really the way God gave it to me that's never really left was sanctification is basically that progressive work of forward and upward, like a staircase, right? A staircase, it's not instant, not unless you've got an escalator, but it's forward and upward step by step, but every step forward is upward as well. If it's truly a work of God's Spirit, if it's a work of transformation, and then you enter into a plateau area. So for me, sanctification was not just being set apart for God, but it was a separation unto him in my course of life to be yielded to him to take me from one level to another. How many have been in churches where they said, we've just reached another level? I always used to kind of tongue-in-cheek that one because I'm going, show me, prove it to me, tell me how to do that. Because that's a nice concept, but I want to know if everybody is, because my experience in pastoring is that a lot of people have grown in biblical literacy but have not grown in experientially growing in the grace and in the knowledge of God. So I want to see if we're climbing the stairway, but I wanted a practical way. And I found a practical way in the scripture. So today's going to be a day of self-evaluation. No, not really self-evaluation, but you can let the word discern your heart and see where you're at today. Because the beautiful thing about sanctification is that every time there is a measure of that reality in you that changes you, God leaves a deposit of himself, almost like a residue of his nature that becomes, you become a partaker of that divine nature. And it's the reality of Christ. So every truth needs cultivated, and every truth that's cultivated needs to bear fruit otherwise it's just head knowledge. So you test yourself by the fruit. You shall know them by their fruit, not by their words, not by their gestures, but by their fruit. And so the Lord's been dealing with me since the first of the year about the progressive work and steps and the God story. And I look back on every sermon from January on till now, and I see his story in sermons. In other words, it doesn't end. It's like it's a book of life that continues day by day in your relationship with him. And if you're obedient, there should be change and transformation and growth. And so we call that term, by the way, intentional sanctification. Do you like that word, intentional sanctification? What would not intentional sanctification be? That'd be, I only deal with stuff in life when I have a meltdown or a severe problem. Then I go, God. Otherwise, I'm pretty much on my own way, doing what I want to do when I want to do it. And as PayPal has said, have you ever seen that new advertisement on PayPal? They know how to appeal to the carnal nature at the speed of want. That was like McDonald's did that years ago. You deserve a break today. You need to get away, right? Wasn't that McDonald's? There's somebody. But anyway, to appeal to the lowest self-absorbed carnal nature usually grabs us at the speed of want. Everybody's going to sign up for PayPal now because they will give you at the speed of want in this instant society. But nonetheless, it doesn't work that way in the kingdom. It was interesting that probably the most difficult thing is the more intelligent you are, probably the more frustrated you will be with revelation because you can't figure it out. You're going to have to know when you're knower, even though you've lived your whole life very confident of this knower. I wonder if that's why they even said that in James. Not many wise among you. I wonder if the head gets in the way. Think your head gets in the way? I know some fools that their head gets in the way. So I guess we're without excuse. Intelligent, not intelligent. God is no respecter of persons. He's got truth to minister to you if you'll cultivate it and develop fruit. Now, intentional sanctification is when you come to the presence of the Lord on a daily basis to honor him. When you close your eyes, you honor him. And I'm honoring God and I'm closing my eyes and I feel wonderful. I'm getting lost in the euphoria of his peace and I'm experiencing his presence. And then you know what I do? Intentional sanctification. Right when I'm enjoying and everything's nice, I purposely say, God, search my heart and see if there's any anxious thought, hurtful way. Any emo cognition, any emo volition, anything in me where the emotions are controlling my thinking and the emotions are controlling my choices, anything soulish in me. Now, you know, a lot of people say, I feel great. I don't have to deal with nothing. That's because you're operating out of those 2,000 cognitive brain cells in the conscious. No. In the things of God, you don't let them search your conscious mind. You already know what's in there. And most of it is being wasted right now by, I'm too hot, I'm too cold. Are they going to turn the air conditioning on? How long is this sermon? You know, you're wasting all of the conscious. But the minute you drop to your spirit and you close your eyes and you say, God, search my heart, he goes into the 400 billion non-conscious areas and brings them to the surface for you to deal with. Let him pick the cherries. That's intentional sanctification. Do that on a good day when it's sunny and you don't really feel like doing anything else but actually satisfying your flesh. All right? That's intentional sanctification. Do it in the morning, preferably. And what God's been saying then is with intentional sanctification, that there is a stairway. And in Amos, if you have your Bibles, I want you to open to Amos. I believe this is where we're at. We're there as a church. Perhaps the church at large is in the same place in many respects. But in Amos chapter 9, it talks in verse 6, it begins with, he who builds his layers in the sky and has founded his strata in the earth. That little term there, layers, means steps, stairs. It's derived from the word ascend, to go up, forward and upward. And in the Psalms, and this is something that I don't know if all of you pay much attention to, I look at it on occasion periodically, and that is the Psalms of ascent. That means the Psalms that go up the steps, forward and upward, are Psalms 120 to 134. And if you want to know kind of where your life is most of the time, start with 120 and see which of the Psalms depict where you're at most of the time. And you can kind of tell you what level you're at. Instead of your biblical knowledge, find out where your character or your development's at. Which one sounds like where you live most of the time? Not all the time, but most of the time. What is your general consciousness or your attitude in the things of God? I think that would put a far greater test on our spirit, because it doesn't have anything to do with your Bible knowledge or your gifting. It would have to do with your character development, out of your relationship in God, sanctification, forward and upward in God, growing in the grace and in the true knowledge of God. All right? So Amos 9, basically verse 6 says, he who builds his layers, his steps in the sky, and has founded his strata in the earth. That word strata actually refers to troops of all things. And so I'm thinking, if God in the heavenlies wants to get heaven on earth, then he would take that divine nature and get it into the believers on earth. But I think there's layers, don't you? Do you think there's, just like there's different kinds of soils, don't you think there's different applications of heart to the degree you receive? Take heed how you hear is really take heed how you receive and drink and feed. I believe there's a demarcation even in the body of Christ as far as spiritual hunger between feeding and drinking and reading and thinking. How many, I used to see friends of mine frustrated. They told me in church to pray and read my Bible. I've been praying and read my Bible and I'm still irritated as all get out. All right? I don't see any change in their life. The praying and the reading didn't do it because they're praying and they're reading. And we're going to get into that, because I think that what we're going to get into, and I believe God's given us some keys on how to step forward and upward. How to step forward. Not just tell you because you're supposed to. All right? So, and we're not going to go through 15 steps, so all of you can take a deep sigh of relief that I'm not going to teach Psalm 120 to 134. So, anyway. But the, let me speed up past in that same chapter 9 about the layers and the strata, and we'll get into that. Strata, by the way, means troops. So that means he wants to build layers in the believer because he's equipping an army. Wouldn't an army have to be equipped and prepared? Wouldn't they have to be mature? Gideon's army, he weeded out the people that had too much fear. So anyway, we're going to get into the layers and the strata and the development of those and moving forward and upward in the steps of God by internal change or intentional sanctification. Now, I want to pass on a little bit, because in the context of the ninth chapter, it's talking about the destruction of Israel, and then it's talking about God's plan to restore them. And I really believe that God is saying that we're in this time, and we are experiencing this ourselves, Jennifer and I for sure, especially when it comes to the books right now. It's basically, God says, in that day, I will build. Who's going to build? I will build. And we'll get to that later too. No, I'm going to get to that right now. I will build my church. Do you know in the rebuke to the seven churches, this is a sidetrack here, but it's important. The rebuke to the seven churches, the message to the seven churches rather, the rebukes and the good points, that in three of those elements, It was referring to dining. It was basically drink of me, feed of me, whether it's the tree of life or the hidden manna, and it's drink and feed. Because without that revelation, you do not build. Without revelation, you do not grow forward and upward in the things of God. And it's about feeding and drinking. It's about dining with the Lord Jesus himself. Unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no part in me. Remember, many were turned away by that statement. But I'm telling you, there is a distinction between the dining, and I believe that the distinction is going to be made on the steps moving forward and upward. The distinction is going to be onto whether or not you have done something with the revelation God gives you. Because if revelation does not change into transformation, you're going to stay at a particular level regardless of biblical literacy, regardless of your gifting. And so I want to be challenged to this day to say, well, why should I even go forward and upward? Because if you don't, you will get stuck in religion. And I've seen more wounded, burned out, negative. There's nothing meaner on the face of the earth than an angry religious person. Really? Really? It's not those pagans. Give me an angry religious person. We went to Russia and did a missions trip, and we were witnessing to people that were said they were KGB cab drivers that were packing guns and children and soldiers, and everybody was responsive. But then the religious people came out with the full battle array, you know, the helmets and the robes. And they came and they looked like they were all demonic. They were snarling and making manifestations in their face and cursing us. And I'm going, isn't that something? Everybody else was open to the message of Jesus Christ from all walks of life, from the babushkas to the children, you know. And it was a beautiful thing to see. And the soldiers, but the religious people. So I say, boy, isn't that, the enemy likes religion. He likes to use it to his own advantage to bring condemnation, guilt, and to keep you less than. But God is about moving forward and upward, and he's going to teach us how. I really believe he is in the process of teaching us how. But in this, I will build, we're going to have to learn the difference between reading and thinking and feeding and drinking, aren't we? It's going to have to be the reality. It's going to have to be Jesus. There's no other foundation than the foundation of Jesus Christ, right? There's no other foundation. And if you don't have a revelation of Jesus Christ, you just know about Jesus Christ. And that foundation of Jesus Christ is built upon the foundation of apostles and prophets. And what was built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, who in fact had a revelation of Jesus Christ. If you don't have a revelation of Jesus Christ, you're a false apostle or a false prophet, and that was part of the charge to some of the churches in the seven churches in Revelations. False apostles and false prophets. You don't have a right to build. God says, I will build my church, and to whomever I delegate with the authority to build, and they have to build according to my pattern, not theirs. So, that's a side element. But God is saying, I am restoring in this day from that stairway. I'm off on a tangent now, you know that. Just nod your head and say, he's on a tangent now. I don't know where he's going with this. I know where I'm going with this. I always come back. All right. But God is restoring the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. He wants the beauty of free worship that actually transforms, not cutesy poo. But transforms. And you can't give something you don't have. All right? And we're going to get to that at the end. But I will raise up the ruins. I will rebuild in the days of old. They must possess the remnant of their enemies. That means you swallow up their enemies, and there's going to be plenty of room for the Gentiles. That means the whosoever will is going to come, because the magnetic force of the Lord is going to draw, and he wants it open to all. And so, Father, we just thank you that, behold, the days are coming. Jennifer got the verse this morning. The days are coming and now is. All right? So, to me, this is a present tense word. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when the plowman shall overtake the reaper. I mean, our first book, now we have the DVD series to it, To Live Free. The second book is coming this week. The third book has already been submitted. The fourth book is in process. And it's like God is like taking the plowman and he's overtaken. And it's like just in the context of books right now, Destiny Image is going to have to hold them back. It's almost like because you can't just keep putting them out all at the same time, something might get overlooked. But in reality, God is basically taking the years the locusts have eaten and he's brought an acceleration. And truly, I believe if the heart is right, you don't have to be a perfect person. All you have to do is have your heart clean and right before God. You're going to be in that accelerated time and season, because to me, that's for the whole church. That's for everybody. That's for the whosoever will. Now, these layers basically are like a staircase in the sky. Remember the angels of God ascending and descending. Remember Jacob's ladder. When he laid upon the rock, he saw a portal open in the heaven and the angels of God ascending and descending. The portal is very important because that's the place where God wants to walk. He wants to bring heaven on earth. He's still in heaven, but oh, the preciousness of that gold that he put within us as the divine nature. He wants that to grow in layers. Intentional sanctification is continually building spiritual prowess, layers, equipping an army to be strong, and knowing that even in this world, there must be resistance for you to be victorious. There must be an obstacle to be victorious. There must be resistance, or there's no real war. You're just playing. You're pretending. So God's going to teach us how to overcome, and actually all the promises, even in Revelation, was to the overcomers. Overcomers mean people who will take the next step when prompted. And let me get into this a little bit. First of all, why should I even bother getting to ascend? We said because if you don't, you get stuck in religion. But if you do, there is going to be an intimacy with God and you'll never fear. Did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out devils? And he says, I knew you not. No. You're going to know him. You're going to know him and be known by him, and you're going to be owned by him. That's Jennifer and I's prayer, to not just know him and be known by him, but to be owned by him. You will gain in spiritual strength to the degree you resist. By resist, I am not talking willpower. To the degree that you resist by the power of the Holy Spirit, letting the peace of God rule and Jesus ruling. When peace rules and you resist the chaos and the anarchy that's all around you, you basically, to the degree that you hold your heart open, you build spiritual prowess. So as you move forward and upward in God, you get stronger. You'll see people having meltdowns over things that mildly irritate you. That's a good sign. That's proof that there's fruit to the cultivation of the reality of a truth. Now, you'll do great exploits. Who's going to do exploits except those that have some spiritual muscle and it's been developed by reason of use? You begin to move into the glory. Genesis 28:12, behold, a ladder, a stairway was set up on the earth and its top reached to heaven, and there were angels of God ascending and descending. We've had more and more people saying they've been seeing angels and angelic visitation in our midst, and I believe that basically this is a time to where they are gathering, and the gathering is to whosoever, but I believe that people have a choice to respond or not to respond, and that's what we're going to see in the days ahead. He rested his head on a rock and opened a portal to heaven. That portal opened up, and he basically says, surely there is a door been opened in heaven, and that open door, doesn't he not say in the Revelation, come up hither? But there's a portal, and I think we need to understand that it's one accord that provides access to that portal. The opening for God, Jennifer always liked to use that coffee maker. She just loved it when we got the coffee maker, that when you pulled it out, it automatically stopped. But when it was in proper alignment, it poured out. And that's really what God's basically saying, alignment. Those people in the upper room were not perfect people, but they found the place where God said, tarry here. So it was a place designated, a time by God, but the condition of the people was to simply get in alignment and be in one accord. Not perfect in doctrine, but one accord. You would think it was easier, or it should be easy, but unfortunately it's not, and we're going to find out why. But anyway, we're in this time to where I believe God says, I'm going to raise up the tabernacle of David, and after this time, I'm going to return and I'm going to rebuild. I believe God's rebuilding, but I believe that he's messing with our foundation, because the foundations have to be repaired before you build anything on it. So if there's anything wrong on our foundation, and the foundation and the most extremely important foundation is the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you don't have a revelation of Jesus Christ, you're not really building a foundation on knowledge about him. And then you need an assignment to obey from that place of revelation. And that revelation needs to actually change you. I want to look at the way I saw this forward and upward look, even in the life of Apostle Paul. And you don't have to look this up, but in chapter 3, in Philippians 3, verses 12 to 14, he had an approach that I think is healthy, that would be healthy for all of us. He had an inward look, and this is healthy for all of us. Not that I've already attained or I am already perfected. Isn't that great? I haven't arrived yet. That's a healthy inward look. At the same time, within the same verse of Scripture, he had a healthy backward look. He said, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. And those things were not just failures and mistakes and regrets, all of which can be a trap and lock you into the past. But he was talking about past accomplishments. You can rest on a platform or a step of past accomplishments. And he says, I'm forgetting those things. Matter of fact, some of those things were rubbish compared to growing in the grace and in the knowledge of God. Compared to knowing my Jesus, those accomplishments are nothing, considered garbage. So my backward look was forgetting those things which are behind. But I have a forward and an upward look. And he says, reaching forward to those things which are ahead. That should be the passion of every believer. Not getting entangled by the past or the present, but basically looking forward to dealing properly in the present, however, but looking forward to those things which are ahead. And then he had the upward look. And this is where I saw sanctification, or the intentional sanctification, being expressed verbally in his own writings. He said, reaching forward to those things which are ahead, forward, I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call. He knew it was both forward and upward, like a staircase. And I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of Christ Jesus. Okay, now we're going to get in the nitty gritty. How do I ascend? Everybody told me to grow in grace and in the knowledge of God. Everybody told me, put off the old man, put on the new man. All right. I love the in-between part that we don't talk about. How do I do this? All right. Are you ready? There's 6 elements to taking a step upward. 6 elements that have to come out of your relationship with Jesus Christ. You could shorten them, but it's got to be a relationship nonetheless. Isaiah 1:19 is a good verse to kind of depict where we start. Isaiah 1:19 says, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. So if I move forward and upward in God, there's a promise of rich satisfaction in God. Rich, deep satisfaction in God. He satisfies the priests with good things. We're talking feeding and drinking. All right, we're talking about dining in the presence of God. Feeding on the manna, the hidden manna even. All right? And it says, if you are willing, element number 1 to moving forward and upward. Say this with me. If. Isn't that the weakness in the personal prophecy? If you want to call it a weakness. It's conditional. If the person follows on to know the Lord. It's not a guarantee. Huh? There's man's part as well as God's part. If. That's a big word. We could do a whole sermon just on if. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves, pray. That's if. If you are willing. If you are willing. Willingness, the next element. Okay, so what if you say, I passed the if test, okay, I will. Then what is willingness? Willingness is that my self-life no longer controls my desires and my actions. Write that down and spend 20 minutes on it. My self-life no longer controls. Underline the word controls. My self-life no longer controls my desires and my actions. In ministry, one of the most common things that I've run into is I've watched people stay at a low level of Christianity, regardless of biblical knowledge, regardless of their ability to tap into revelation, is that the desires of their heart were not the desires of God's heart. They misapplied that to get what they want. Well, truly, God would want me to have a house on the beach. Yeah, I've heard that one. Yeah, he may even grant you what you desire, but he put leanness in your soul as well. You know, let's balance out your interpretation. Because unless there is alignment with the will of God, the desires of your heart need to match his heart. The will was meant and created by God to be a divine romance of my will and his will are one. Therefore, the desires of my heart are his desires. I want his prayer requests, not my wants and needs. Do you think we would lose somebody on a step there? There alone. You could level your Christian life for the rest of your Christian life, regardless of how much knowledge you grow in. You could just stay there because you want what you want and you haven't been able to let it go. I want my beach house and I want it now. And if I don't get it now, I'm going to get it one way or another. All right? So if is the first element. Willingness needs to be properly understood. The third element is a spirit of obedience. In other words, if I am willing, then I need to have a spirit of obedience in me that responds to God's request. I want what God wants. If I want what God wants, then John 7:17 becomes a relational experience instead of just a scripture you quote. John 7:17 is Jesus. It's his reality. It says, if anyone wills to do his will, he shall know. If I'm willing and have a spirit of obedience, I will know. God will give you revelation. He's not going to hide from you. He's hiding himself for you to pursue him. People struggle and don't know what's going on. I don't get revelation. I hear people get revelation all the time. I don't get revelation. It could be the problem with the if and the will. Are you willing to obey what he shows you? Or are you still locked into what you want? Your plans, your agendas. But if is I am willing, and if you are willing, you shall know. You shall get the revelation. A spirit of obedience sets you up for what I call the riser. The riser in a step. Do you know what a riser is in a step? It's that, we would call it the kick plate. You can stay on a step and look at the obstacle of that kick plate and never move to another level. Until God gives the revelation of how to overcome. When he gives you the revelation of the overcome, then because of practical application where you become a doer of that revelation, you now have experience that lifts you over the riser to the next step. Do I need to go slow on that? You don't get up the next step with self-effort or striving. The next step is it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. And the spirit will lift you in the will of God when your will is the will of God and you're willing to obey. And then once you have experienced, because of obedience, you actually get above the riser. And by the way, where there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint and they stay at a level. Where there's no prophetic vision, the people cast off restraint. Where there is no redemptive revelation, the people cast off restraint. And remember, we said built upon the Lord Jesus Christ through a personal, intimate relationship based on the foundation of apostles and prophets who have a right to build because they're building and allowing God to build through them as he directs. Does that make sense? So you'd understand that a false prophet doesn't have a right to build. A false apostle doesn't have a right to build. No revelation. Now, if the spirit of obedience takes me up over the riser to another level, then that step has actually caused me to enter into, because of my obedience, it's caused me to enter into a level of reality or growth or sanctification. I've entered into a reality of good works. Good works are God works. Why? Because God is building and God has prepared you before the foundation of the world unto good works. I wonder how many people are just doing their own thing. And you know what's scary about this thing? Is that we're all believers and God loves everybody, but do you realize at the same time, did you ever get on the fourth step and have to talk to someone on the first step? I'm not talking about condescending. I'm talking about the inability to communicate. I'm not talking about mutual respect. I'm talking about the inability to communicate. Some people can communicate at this level because they're comfortable at that level. What would you rather be, an expert in kindergarten or a student in the first grade, is really what it amounts to. The steps of the Lord say, I want to face the obstacles and circumstances in my life, get the revelation to get above the riser to the next level so that whatever I'm facing is not the same old. If you're seeing the same old, you've probably plateaued years ago and your biblical knowledge has increased. Your gifting may even increase, but your platform is the same. Because only revelation moves you to the next level of maturity. You grow in the grace and in the knowledge of God. So the riser then is basically that thing that you're facing in your life. And what God is looking for is a proper response. Some people get hung up on, is that God or is that the devil coming at me? It's really how you respond to it is actually more important. Respond godly. And get the revelation of what God is speaking and then allow that revelation to say, I will obey it. In other words, all of these are elements of trust, not figuring out. Figuring out doesn't work. It's all elements of trust that you move to the next level. So your revelation experience because of obedience, you enter into the good works that God has for you. And that act of obedience carries you to the top of the riser and builds a new step or a platform. Ever wonder what platform you're on? There's a way to check, and we're going to mess with you today. You can find out where you're at. There he's going to he's saying all this stuff, and I don't know if I want to do this. Okay, but the six elements are if, willingness, obedience, the riser, the step, and the platform. We really broke down forward and upward, but how to do it. Interestingly enough, though, it explains the scripture about Jesus. You ever wondered about Hebrews 5, 8, 9, where it says, though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. Jesus lived as a man, though he was God, he learned obedience. That used to confuse me. I'm going, what did he have to learn? He should know everything. No, he learned obedience in a practical application is because every obstacle he yielded to the will of the Father and overcame and went to the next level. And then every step of obedience, everything that he suffered, everything in your life that is a barrier, God has a solution to it, but it's by revelation and it's out of relationship. It's not out of figuring it out. You won't figure it out. You need a relationship. You need to inquire and require of him as to how to move forward and upward every step of the way. David did that, didn't he? As a mighty warrior, he never got cocky at his approach. He basically knew that he had to inquire of the Lord for a different strategy all the time. So is your life. And if you see your life as the same old, going around the same old mountain, then perhaps you're on a platform and you haven't sought God to get to the next level. Now, Jesus overcame all of the temptations to go his own way. That's what you face on every riser on a stairwell. You face that. Now, I want to get to the good stuff here. Now for the sermon. Now first we're going to go slow on this part because I noticed the first service needed this. Revelation in and of itself is not enough. Say that with me. Revelation in and of itself is not enough. We must be obedient in divinely arranged circumstances for it to become personal reality. Oh, so you mean we need life? This is rehearsal for heaven. I have to practice down here, and there are assorted circumstances and people in my life of which I'm going to be allowed to overcome and experience in reality. God's going to ask us to do what we don't want to do. Isn't that interesting that Peter had to be told in advance, day's going to come when people are going to take you by a way you don't want to go. That probably really pushed his button. Don't tell me that didn't push his button. If somebody came up to you and says, God's going to take you by a way you don't want to go. Don't tell me that wouldn't push your button if you're really human. But if you really want to move forward and upward, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. A spirit of obedience will get you over the riser to the next level. Now, here's the part that excites me is that the work of the cross is our acceptance of his will in the place of intense pressure. Isn't that exciting? In the place of intense pressure, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. I know all of you say that all the time though, right? Don't you all? You have that on your refrigerator, right? Oh, though he slay me, yet I will trust him. I'll tell you what, it's a more implicit. What's missing in the church is trust, and trust is the foundation of the building blocks of character. Without it, you won't grow. You won't know the love of God even without trust. Unless you trust him to come in, you'll never know the love of God. You got to start with trust. That's the foundation. Okay, but here's the message. I got 15 more minutes to give you the message of my heart. Are you ready? I wasn't going to mess with you with all 15 steps because I figured the introduction will take long enough. But the top 5 steps of the Psalms of Ascent. And they say that the priests may very well have sung these psalms on every step. But I'll tell you what, it's easy to sing a song and it's easy to quote the scripture, but it's a whole nother thing to actually go through the process that gets you from one level to another. So you read Psalm 120 to 134, and you say, what does that, which one of those sounds like my life right now? And then find out what is the good and the bad in the psalm. That's how you get up over to the next psalm. And if you look at Psalm 120, you're just a victim. Do you think there's people that are biblically literate that are still a victim in the family of God, that they still perceive themselves as a victim instead of a conqueror? All right, we're just going to look at the last 5 steps because I believe this is to a large degree, an emphasis of what we want to deliver in our ministry. I believe, too, that if the church is going to mature, we're going to have to be challenged by these last 5 steps. Don't you want to reach the top? I mean, what if the Old Testament priest went all 15 steps, why in the world would I want to stay at step 5 my whole Christian life and be the most knowledgeable person on step 5 character? Some people like that. I had a guy one time say, you know, I know God wants me to study under you, but right now I'm teaching 3 men in my dead church where nobody's saved. You're teaching unsaved people. God wants you to study and learn something, but you'd rather teach. If you're winning them to the Lord, I'd say, go for it. but he had a need to be needed and never got beyond that platform of being a student because he had such a need to be needed in that position that he couldn't relinquish it and move. That'd be like being in the third grade and going, I know I graduated, but I ain't going. I like this teacher and I ain't going. I don't know that next teacher, so why should I go? I'm going to stay here. And besides that, when we do it over again, I like it because I'll know the answers. And then I can have my hand raised up and I can be seen and heard in class all the time. That's flesh, right? All right, are you ready? This is the season of annihilation of the flesh. But remember, if it sounds too hard, without the grace of God, you can't do it anyway, right? Grace is empowerment, and God wants to empower you with this. Psalm 130. When you read Psalm 130, the primary portion of that, you can pull all different things out of it, but the bottom line is plumbing the depths of forgiveness in Christ Jesus setting you free. Finding the beauty of that pain and sorrow fleeing and shalom replacing it. How many people do you think have entered into the realm of forgiveness and repentance to such a degree that it's a lifestyle that for the most part there's no pain or sorrow in their life? If it is, it's momentary and is replaced with shalom automatically. Do you know that's what we teach? That's our starting place. That's basically our message. If you study any of our material, our message is to say we've got to open the eyes of the church to more clearly see the beauty of that gift, that all of the messages of the gospel are gospels. The gospel is a message of peace, peace with God and peace with one another. Pursue peace with all people. And basically that everything that removes what's coming between you and God and you and people is repentance and forgiveness. Go preach the forgiveness of sin in John chapter 20 after the resurrection. Luke 24, go preach the remission of sin after the resurrection. Before he died on the cross, Father, forgive them. Forgive this man the message. Go preach forgiveness. You want to preach a love message, you preach forgiveness because that's where the rubber meets the road. It's easy to love, 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 love. You start forgive, bless them that curse you, pray for them that despitefully use you, do good to them that hate you. Then you're entering into a realm of the supernatural because God's doing that by his grace and by his power, not in your own ability, but by a spirit of obedience and by revelation, God will take care of and flow through you. So the depths of redemption through forgiveness, pain and sorrow versus shalom. I know quality men and women of God that still believe, just forgive and live with the pain. That's in their theology. And these are good people, but that's in their theology. And I'm saying that there's a place in God where he takes your pain and your sorrow. As a matter of fact, Bill Morford's translation of the shalom of God in the One New Man Bible, basically shalom means no injustice and no pain. You can't have peace and pain at the same time. Unless it's physical pain and you've got peace in your heart. But in your spirit, peace rules, it removes pain. And in Psalm 130, there is a significant revelation of having dealt with the bent towards selfishness, the iniquity, the bent of self. You can take your time and look at all of these, but I'll tell you what, it's a beautiful progression that really, really the power is broken of self. Self really is not most of the time ruling. You're at a place where forgiveness is ruling as a lifestyle, and I'm staying in a healthy communion with God, and pain and sorrow have been replaced that most of the time, the vast majority of the time, I live in peace. We've got Christians that live in almost a low grade of anxiety as a constant. That's not maturity. No matter how gifted you are, no matter how biblically literate you are, that is not maturity. Low-grade anxiety means there's something coming between you and God in the prayer realm. Be anxious for nothing but by prayer of being with a person. And God has always, all of all of the doctrines of God are doctrines of peace. So Psalm 130 would be a step to maintain as normative, wouldn't it? Wouldn't that like to be a nice step to be normative? Fifth from the top of the steps in a progression of development. Also at this place, and he shall redeem from all Israel from all its iniquities. There is something that I want to see take place, a redemptive orientation toward life. In other words, you see the gold. You're aware of the dirt, but you see the gold. And that when you speak the truth in love, you're always asking yourself, where's the redemption in what I just spoke? And you get redemptive oriented. I'd love to see the church at the fifth step as a constant, wouldn't you? That their outlook would always be redemptive. Where's the redemption in what I'm saying or doing or be or acting? Psalm 131. This is going to be necessary because the enemy wants to wear out the saints of the Most High God, but they that know their God intimately shall be strong and do exploits. Psalm 131 is the place of perfect peace. Shalom, shalom. It's the place where you don't see burnout anymore because it's a place where you stop striving. Isn't that what that says? Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor my eyes lofty. Neither do I concern myself with great matters, nor things that are too proud. I have calmed and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. We teach this over and over again in the modules, that you don't even meet God in prayer until you calm and quiet your flesh. Until that mind, will, and emotions is subordinate to the work of the Spirit, you don't even meet him. Therefore, God's saying, this is the place. This is the place of shalom, shalom. This is the place where I stop striving. And normal for me is the rule of peace, regardless of a hostile environment, regardless of my work situation, regardless that everybody there is a whacked out demonic person, including my boss. Regardless, I'm in the place where I don't strive. Because I'm under the lordship of Jesus Christ. I'm a Sabbath son and a Sabbath daughter. The Sabbath is not just Sunday. The Sabbath is entering into the rest of faith. And that rest as Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters means that's the way I live 7 days a week. And it has nothing to do with people or circumstances. Wouldn't that step four from the top be a wonderful place to dwell most of the time? And if you don't, you've already learned and have got so acquainted with step Psalm 130 to where the place of forgiveness is that if you slip, you receive forgiveness and repentance and get your peace back instantly. You don't want nothing coming between what you and God have together. These are the steps of ascension. This is the forward and the upward, the place of perfect peace, the place of Sabbath sons and daughters. Psalm 132. This is a place that is the dwelling place, Bethlehem, Zion. Oh, Israel, you ought all dwell in Bethlehem and Zion. But it's basically Ephesians 2:22 from our heart. When we formed Kingdom Life Church, God told Jennifer and I that I want a habitation of God, a dwelling place where living stones are built up as a habitation, not a crowd. Not a crowd. The difference between Bethlehem and Ai, or Bethel and Ai rather, is Bethel means a house of stone, a habitation of God, a house of God. Ai is a heap of stones. You can have heaps of stones and never have them knit. Because how do we get knit even? How do we get that unity? That has to be a work of the Spirit, and there has to be an if and an obedience and a want to and a cooperation for the Holy Spirit like a magnet to do it. By the way, Psalm 132 is a level where corporateness is not a difficult concept. Do you know how many people really believe they're mature but are terrified of corporateness? They would rather be in a crowd than relationally vulnerable. But God's looking for a dwelling place to where he could say, our Father which art in heaven, we are coming together. We try to do that in worship. I want to break that habit of an audience of one. You do an audience of one at home. When you're in a corporate setting, you include brothers and sisters, because there's something in the corporate that you can't have by yourself. But you, if you're not open to one another, you can't have it then. Because God's saying an openness to both God and one another, he becomes a dwelling place. He inhabits those praises of his people corporately. And he wants to rise up and speak in out of the corporate unity. So this is a dwelling place of God, a habitation of God in the Spirit. Psalm 133. I used to think Psalm 133 was the top of the steps, but it's not. The place of unity and anointing. It's the place where all of a sudden, unity is not a threatening thing. It's a want to, and it's a destiny producer. All of a sudden, there is an anointing that you can't have by yourself. There are certain gifts and anointings that unless you're corporate, you will never see them take place. There's a whole lot of things we're doing now that basically, if it wasn't for corporate, it wouldn't happen. It's just that simple. It's the place of unity and anointing, but there's also another thing. In the Psalm 133, oh, that anointing that flows down Aaron's beard, how beautiful and precious it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the precious oil. And, you know, he basically says, I'm going to do a lot of things. In that place of unity, in that place of satisfaction, in that place of commanded blessing, in that place of supernatural growth, God says, I will dwell, I will abundantly bless, I will satisfy her poor with bread. I will clothe. That's a beautiful place to be. But look where that promise is conditional upon an alignment. It's a condition upon being open to one another as well as to God. God's basically saying there is a provision for the saints in unity that doesn't exist just for the individual. There's blessings for the individual, but this is a satisfaction that you can't find. As a matter of fact, when the priests of Zadok, their portion was God, God himself. And he's basically saying that I'm going to provide all of these things. I will be a lamp. Your enemies will be clothed with shame. But this is the place for unity. This is the place for the commanded blessing, and this is the place for true growth, the place of unity, the Psalm 133 anointing. I believe there's going to have to be a measure of that for God to descend with the kind of dwelling he wants to dwell. But the last one, like I said, for years, I thought 133 should have been the top of the steps. I didn't understand. But then when I saw Psalm 134, that basically Psalm 134 was the place to where you don't get to the top of the steps and say, oh, we're in unity, what a blessing. It's almost as if at the top of the steps, you should turn and face the children and the children's children and say, actually, all that's been given I got from God, I now have something worth giving that I can reproduce according to kind. Because no matter what step you're on, when you reproduce at that level. You only reproduce according to kind of spiritual nature, character. But to stand at that top and to minister to the body, I want to reach the pinnacle to minister to the body, to know that what I'm giving them is a substance beyond what they could get with deep teaching. Most of the body needs deeper nature, not deeper teaching. We like deeper teaching, but deeper nature would do us a lot more good. Nature change. So I believe that Psalm 134 is the place to minister to the body. That my name on the children of Israel, I will bless them. I'm going to bless the name of the children of Israel. But here's what I saw. Recently, we saw our friend Bill Morford was on Sid Roth, and he was covering some of the things he discovered in his Bible that he said are not accurate translations. And the one that caught my attention was right here. And that is the Aaronic blessing that's been spoken for years and for generations. You know, the Lord bless you and keep you, may the Lord face shine upon you and be gracious. He says, that's not as accurate as, of course, he loves a split hair. Sometimes I'd go, I don't get it. You know, what's the difference? It sounds pretty good to me either way. But he said, the Lord will bless you and keep you. The Lord will make his face shine upon you. He will be gracious to you. The Lord will lift his countenance upon you. He will establish shalom for you. And they will put my name on the children of Israel, and I will bless them. Name and nature are synonymous to me. I will put my nature, but you can't give something you don't have. I will put my name and my nature on the children. I'll tell you what, spiritual children and natural children, I believe the more we move forward and upward in God, the more we've got to give to the next generation. You talk about a generational blessing. Most of us are trapped in generational curses, and we're worried about the generational sin. I'll tell you what, you need to start pressing on upward and forward to the generational blessing, to the children and the children's children. But you can only give them what's real to you. And I want to pass on as much as possible. And that way, there should be no retirement mentality in the church. You should be saying, to what degree can I pursue God in character and in nature and grow in the grace and the knowledge of God and turn and give that blessing to the children, spiritual and others, to congregations and to others. I'll tell you what, there's a whole lot of talk, but I'll tell you what, the real character change is have this attitude that was in Christ Jesus. Having that attitude is a whole lot different than prophesying it, preaching it, or talking about it. It's a whole lot easier than singing songs and going up the steps and singing all those psalms. Getting those psalms to bring the revelation to where you literally move up by revelation and obedience through transformation because of life experience to where you own it. I believe that here's what God's going to do. I'm going to pray this prayer on how to literally prepare ourselves to move forward and upward, how the revelation can then take us to the new. This attitude that was in Christ Jesus would be in us. And that attitude in him was, if anyone wills to do his will, you shall know. So guess what? We're without excuse. If you really want to do the will of God, and you want to face those barriers and those risers that are in your life and move to the next level, then you've got to say, basically, I am willing and obedient to do it. Therefore, God will give me the revelation. Then I must act obediently on that revelation. All right? And here's the scripture that Jennifer and I are praying. If you want to pray it as a church, fine. If you're watching by Ustream and you want to write this down, 1 Corinthians 8, verse 3 in the Amplified Bible. Because this is where the rubber meets the road. Test yourself with the scripture. Let the scriptures discern your heart. If one really, truly loves God with affectionate reverence, prompt obedience, and grateful recognition of his blessings in your life, this is the person that is known by God, recognized as worthy of his intimacy and love, and is owned by him. My passion is to know, to be known. I let him intentionally search my heart. Know him intimately, be known by him, and then be owned by him. Now, how do I do that? I'll pray out loud the prayer I pray for me. There's four elements in the attitude that was in Christ Jesus. And you distill them down into a real short prayer, there's four elements that I pray. This very day, I am asking for and receiving more and greater revelation to make myself of no reputation. My reputation belongs to God. I make myself, don't most people get all bummed out? Somebody said this and somebody said that and this one thinks this and I think that person on the cell phone's talking about me. You know, a little bit of paranoia. But I make myself of no reputation. Give your reputation and put it in the hands of God. That's his business. I receive forgiveness for even being mildly concerned in any fleshly way for my reputation. I make myself of no reputation. Secondly, I receive forgiveness and I ask for revelation to reveal in my life any plan or any agenda that is apart from the good works that God has ordained for me. No plans, no agendas. I receive forgiveness, and I also ask for revelation for anything hidden. If there be a hidden agenda or a hidden plan that is not part of the works of Almighty God, I do not want to do it. I receive forgiveness for any attempt to do a plan or an agenda. I want no reputation, no plan or agenda. And now here's another one. No ownership. If ever there were a stumbling block to moving forward and upward in God, is to think you own. You don't own your children. You don't own your wife. You don't own your house. You don't own your car. You don't own your husband. You don't own anything. People and material, you were called to be a steward and to behave as a manager. You are not an owner. I receive forgiveness for undue ties or hanging on to any person, place, or thing. I am releasing myself to be totally abandoned to a more implicit trust in God. I'm abandoning myself to Him, for I own nothing, for He Himself is going to be my exceedingly great reward. My inheritance is Him. Let it go. If some of you are holding out for something in the future, I believe God just gave me a word of knowledge. God says some of you are holding out for what you're going to get. Let it go. Because it's spoiling your life and the direction of your life. The plans and the purposes that you have are based on what may come. And it reminds me of the prodigal. Father, give me all that is my inheritance. It's going to be a mistake. Let it go. You're planning on something coming, and you're trusting in that more than God. So, Father, I release ownership. I release myself unto You. I am a manager. I am a responsible manager and steward of my children and of my property, but it is not mine. It is Yours, and I'm going to care for them as if it were Yours. And lastly, prompt obedience. No hesitation to obey. I want to train my spirit to respond spontaneously out of a divine romance of wills. Not my will, but Thy will be done. A divine romance of wills, that my will is like putty in Your hand, that I am promptly will obey. Prompt obedience brings me up to the next level. Prompt obedience then brings me the revelation. Then the revelation needs to be obediently acted upon in life circumstances to be at that level and establish that platform. So, Father, I want to go to a new place. That's a little bit more difficult than, okay, ladies and gentlemen, we've just gone to another level. You probably prefer it the other way. We've just gone to another level. Take my word for it. There we go. Oh, yeah, yeah. But to really do it, it's going to take a little bit of devotion to Christ. Did that sound too hard? When I was at a point in my life where someone had a list of complaints and I had an answer for every one of those complaints and God told me to shut up, that really crucifies your flesh. But you know what scripture He gave me when He said shut up? He gave me a scripture I didn't quite understand at the time. He said, God, You are a shield to me, and Your gentleness has made me great. And I'm going, what does that have to do with shutting up? And basically what He showed me in that later on, actually it was the message that helped. He basically said, You protect me with salvation armor. You touch me, and I feel 10 feet tall. And I remember, this was like probably close to 20 years ago now, but I remember 20 years ago when that happened, Thy gentleness has made me great, that when He told me to shut up, He touched me in such a way that I feel what emerged was God confidence. not self-confidence. Self-confidence would have been to pride yourself in the answers. Instead, shut up and let me be. And when he touched me, his gentleness made me great. It was like great. It was like not great, great, but large inside because of a confidence in God that I was little, but God rose up big in me. That was what happened, and that was worth it. So, Father, may God rise up big in each and every one of us as we reveal to the days ahead. How many are going to do your homework and look at Psalm 120 to 134 and try to get an idea? Where does your life seem most of the time? But the goal of our church is the last five steps. The emphasis in all of our teaching will be the last five steps. Again and again and again, all of the teachings will be in the last five steps to bring the church unto full stature, to bring you into maturity. That doesn't mean that all of us don't need recycled down at times to 120 and go back up, because it could be cyclical. But nonetheless, consciousness of where you are most of the time is the essential Christian life. Where are you most of the time is indicative of the kind of Christian life that we want to have. So, Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that he who began a good work is going to continue it. And I thank you, God, that in the days ahead, we're going to move in a God confidence. We're not going to be worn out, and we're going to move in the plans and the purposes of God and enter into God works, not just good ideas and good plans. And that only the building that God has ordained and delegated to us are we going to engage in. And we thank you for that in Christ's name. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.